We have to climb up these trees to save them. It's easily 150, 200 feet up a tree.
Oh, headache, headache.
At the top, we listen to all the sounds of the forest. They'll pick out the sounds of illegal logging. Illegal logging is an extremely profitable business. It is the most profitable way to extract resources from the forest. There's many, many tens of billions of dollars that are made every year by organizations extracting illegal wood, very, very valuable wood from the forest. The destruction of forest leads to more carbon output than all the cars, trucks, trains, ships, planes combined. Of course, the species that are there are very important too. The impacts of the illegal logging and deforestation is very different in different places, but it's very, very rare that logging actually helps a local community in any sort of long-term sense. Whether it be Indonesia or Africa or South America, every time the logging comes in, the forest disappears. There's a loss of livelihood, there's a loss of rain and water, there's a loss of, you know, food supplies. And also any time that there's a lack of law and order, a place where illegal logging is able to generally thrive is not a good sign. This all kind of began in 2011 when I visited the rainforest of Borneo for the first time to volunteer at a given reserve in Indonesia. And while we were there, we kind of noticed that they had these guards, these three guards, whose job was to help protect this small reserve from illegal logging. And in fact, there was lots of illegal logging happening on the outskirts all the time. While there, I realized that these guards were having to walk through the forest to sort of find the loggers. And my background in technology and physics kind of made me feel like I had to be able to build a tool that could help them find the loggers more quickly and in the act. When people think about how to monitor a place, we often think of it visually because, you know, we're visual creatures. But when you're in the forest, you realize that so much like the sound really is the essence of what's there. You can't see more than 20 feet in front of you because there's trees, it's dark, but you can hear things happening just miles away. There's the sounds of gibbons, the sounds of birds, the sounds of insects. It's all just deafening. There's just this constant cacophony of noise. And when you're there, that sort of informs you of what's happening in the forest. You can't see a chainsaw that's happening a mile away, but you can hear the sound. They travel very well through the trees. It was really kind of almost biomimicry to say, how are the animals themselves making themselves known? How are they communicating? It's with sound. That could be a way by which we can pick out the sounds of threats as well. I had some old phones. I figured I could sort of hack them together to listen to the sounds of the forest and pick out the sounds of chainsaws to send alerts to these people so they could actually get there in time. So the Rainforest Connection System, the RFCx platform, really is a full sort of end-to-end type solution. It all begins with what we call a guardian, which are ostensibly phones and boxes up in the treetops.
So this is the Rainforest Connection Guardian. Of course, you have this enclosure on the outside and you have a microphone. It's a very powerful microphone. It allows us to pick up sounds very, very far away. On the inside, here's some batteries actually that helps us harness all the solar power.
They have solar panels so they can last for years. They charge themselves in the daytime and they run 24 hours a day.
And then of course we have attachments for external antennas so we can pick up cell phone service from many, many miles away.
They capture all the sound of the forest. They package it up and send it up to the cloud in real time over the cell phone network. So once it's in the cloud, we can run any number of artificial intelligence models on it. We can pick out chainsaws, gunshots, trucks. And then in real time, we can take those alerts and send them right back to people on the ground through software that we build called the Ranger app and through these web dashboards. So local people, they're able to get these alerts, collaborate through the software and show up in real time if they can to stop the activity. We think that real-time response is potentially the key to de-escalating these events. What often keeps people from stopping these activities is the danger involved. But if you can stop a truck on the way in, you don't necessarily need to confiscate the truck. You don't necessarily need to arrest anybody. You can turn it around and ship it out. The same is true in many cases if you stop them just when they're beginning to cut a tree or cut only one. Phones from 11 years ago, 2008, 2009, they still can do so much. This phone here, it has GPS, it's got accelerometers, it can tell you where it's positioned, it can record all the sound, it can connect to all these cell phone networks, it can compress audio extremely well, and it can send it all up to the cloud. This is an amazing little Internet of Things computer. The only way to protect the natural world is to get the rest of humanity to care about it. We think the sound of our living planet might be the most powerful vector for being able to protect it. And the only way to do that is to get many thousands of these sensors out there, tens of thousands of guardians around the world, streaming all the time, making that data available to scientists, enthusiasts, birdwatchers, students, through accessible and easy platforms. I believe at this point in time, where we have these amazing networks around the world, we have a system like ours that can record and capture the stuff in the cloud, we have cloud computing to be able to look at big data sets and really pull things out, and we have AI. All these things coming together, I think, is really a turning point potentially where sound becomes one of the most important ways for us to study and protect nature.